Changes, we will talk about the senile ptosis, dermatocalysis, and lastly, we will talk about eyelid disorders, eyelid tumors, like different benign and malignant eyelid tumors. Okay, so starting with the anatomy of eyelid, anatomy, eyelid consists of seven layers, starting from outermost part skin and the innermost part palpebral conjunctiva. So the layers are like skin, subcutaneous areolar tissue, layers of striated muscle, orbicularis muscle, then submuscular layer, followed by the fibrous layer. Fibrous layer consists of tarsal plate, and then the layer of unstriated muscle that consists of levator palpebrae muscle and Müller's muscle. And at the end, this is a palpebral conjunctiva. So starting from skin to conjunctiva, it can be divided into seven layers. Okay. So basically there are three major eyelid muscles: orbicularis, levator palpebrae superioris, and Müller's muscle. Orbicularis muscle is supplied by seventh cranial nerve, and it helps to close the eyes. In the palsy of seventh cranial nerve, there is inability to close eye. The condition is called lagophthalmos. Levator palpebrae superioris muscle helps to lift the upper eyelid, and it is supplied by third cranial nerve. That's why in cases of third cranial nerve palsy, we see inability to lift the eyelid, that is ptosis, leading to drooping of eyelid. So Müller's muscle, it helps levator palpebrae superioris muscle to lift the eyelid, and it is supplied by sympathetic supply. It contributes to around 2 millimeter lifting of the upper eyelid. So these are the major muscles: orbicularis, Müller's, and levator. And after that, there are some few glands. The most important and important one is the meibomian gland, which lies in the tarsal plate. It is a fibrous plate. The opening of meibomian glands open outside in the skin, and it is a modified sebaceous gland. Another glands are gland of Zeiss and gland of Mohn. Gland of Zeiss lies at the base of Las follicle, and its duct open into this base. Similarly, gland of Mohn is a sweat gland which lies in between two hair follicles, and its duct open either into the duct of gland of Zeiss or into the Las follicle, but it doesn't open directly into the skin. So normal eyelid, the position of normal eyelid, the upper lid covers around 1/6 part of superior cornea, that is around 2 millimeter of cornea, and lower eyelid just touches the inferior limbus. It has a round anterior border and a sharp posterior border touching the globe. Eyelashes in the upper lid are directed forward, upward, and backward. Lower lids, it is directed forward, downward, and backward. So if there are some misdirection of these lashes, then there are anomalies. So what is the anterior and posterior margin? Or we can see the outermost part where the lashes are there. This is the round anterior margin or anterior border. The innermost, this innermost part, which is in touch with conjunctiva, is a posterior margin or posterior sharp border. In between these two lies the intermarginal stripe. And in the intermarginal stripe, there is one landmark called gray line. This gray line divides the total of the lid into anterior lamella and posterior lamella. So it is very important surgical landmark. It lies in just in front of the meibomian gland orifices opening and behind this eyelash follicles. Okay, after this, okay, suppose this is a case which comes to you in the OPD. It's a around 15-year-old girl complaining of swelling in the right eye, which is painful in nature since 3 days. So what would be the diagnosis?
Stye.
Stye, okay. Stye is also known as External hodulum. Yes, it is a acute suppurative inflammation of gland of Zeiss or mole. Presents with a painful swelling at the lead margin. And there can be some surrounding edema and inflammation. Sometimes raised pus point may be visible like this. You can see the arrow where the visible pus point at the base of last follicle is present. And preauricular lymph nodes may also be present. Sometimes it may present as a abscess also. So this sty can present as a stage of cellulitis or a stage of abscess. It is a infective condition caused most commonly by Staphylococcus, which is a gram-positive organism. So how will we treat this condition? General measure, warm compress and epilation of associated lass to evacuate the pus if such pus point are visible. Since it is an infection, we have to give systemic antibiotic covering gram-positive organism, capsule ampicillin plus cloxacillin 500 mg. The dose is QID 4 times a day. Remember that ampicillin is a short-acting penicillin. That's why it has to be given 4 times a day. Instead of this, we can also give amoxicillin plus clavulanate. 625 mg is the adult dose. That is TDS. Amoxicillin has longer half-life than this ampicillin. That's why it can be given 3 times a day. And oral analgesic for pain, ibuprofen plus paracetamol 3 times a day for initial few days with antacids. Then antibiotic drops and ointment, any fluoroquinolone antibiotic drops and ointment can be given. If abscess is found, then incision and drainage of the abscess should be done. Okay, so this is another case where a middle-aged lady presents to you with a swelling in the upper eyelid, which is painless in nature and it's there for around 2-3 months. So what could be the diagnosis?
Collagen.
Yes, collagen. This is collagen. Why collagen? What is collagen? It is a granulomatous inflammation of meibomian gland. It presents as a painless nodular swelling. And if you note the location, it is slightly away from the lead margin. While sty, they are in the lead margin. And it is slightly away from the lead margin. And there are no signs of inflammation surrounding this nodular swelling, which is present in sty. And large collagen, sometimes they may press the cornea and induce refractive error, usually astigmatism. And in recurrent cases of collagen, we should always rule out diabetes and refractive errors. Refractive errors itself may also induce collagen formation. How? Because of excessive rubbing of eyes to gain clear vision, there is chronic inflammation of meibomian gland. So due to obstruction of the meibomian gland, the secretions are collected inside the meibomian gland and it appears at this nodular swelling. So how do you treat this collagen? In early and small soft lesion, only warm compression and massage will relieve the problem. And how do massage help? Basically, suppose this is a gland and this is a duct. Okay, how do warm compress help? Warm compress will increase the diameter of this opening, that is dilatation of this duct. And warm compress will also help in liquefying this content of the gland. This is called sebum. Sebum, which are solidified in nature, after the warm compression, it will liquefy, plus dilatation of this duct will occur. That's why after vertical massage, then it can come out and relieve the symptoms. So in persistent lesion, which are not getting okay with this conservative management, surgery is needed. That is incision and curettage, where a small incision is given in the lesion and its content are taken out. Sometimes these lesions are very near to punctum and incision and curettage may have risk of damaging canaliculi. In such cases, intralesional steroid 0.1 to 0.2 ml triamcinolone injection is given inside the lesion. So this is another condition of a man who had a history of swelling for 3-4 months, followed by acute painful condition for last 2 days. Okay, what could be the condition? Diagnosis, it can be a internal hardiolum. Internal hardiolum is a condition where there is secondary infection of collagen. Collagen as such is a lipogranulomatous inflammation of the Bowman gland. But when the secondary infection occurs in collagen, it is called internal hardiolum. So how do we manage this case? We have to first treat the acute inflammation by hot fermentation, systemic antibiotics, analgesic with antacids, local antibiotic drops and ointment. And once the acute phase is over, then we can go for incision and curettage. So this is another condition where there can be a small raised lesion at the margin of the lid. This is a marginal collagen. So how they are formed? Sometimes the collagen, there may be a granulation tissue formation at the duct of the gland, and it may project outward as a radius gray nodule in the intermarginal strip. So this condition is called marginal collagen. It is also treated with incision and curettage, and electrocoagulation of the duct can be done after removal of the granulation tissue to prevent recurrence. Collagen, if left untreated, it may sometime burst outside either through conjunctiva or skin and present as a fungating mass of granulation tissue, and it should be treated with granulation tissue excision with cautery of the base and curettage of the incompletely removed content of the collagen. Okay, this old man presents with a nodular swelling in the upper eyelid for 6 month duration, and it is gradually increasing in size. It is a painless. So what could be this condition? Can somebody guess it?
Collagen. Painless.
Oh, it looks like a collagen. It is away from the lid margin and has a nodular swelling, but always remember to evert the lid and see. Okay. When the lid is everted, you can see a solid mass which is in the tarsal plate. Okay. So this is a meibomian carcinoma which is mimicking as a collagen. Okay. Very rarely malignant change may occur in the collagen leading to meibomian gland carcinoma, or it is also called sebaceous cell carcinoma, especially in the old age with the history of recurrence. You should ask the history properly. If there is history of multiple surgeries done before, already he's having history of incision and curettage done for the same problem twice or thrice maybe. In such cases, you should always suspect meibomian gland carcinoma, and excision of the mass with histopathological examination is must in such cases. So always remember, for any lid lesion, always evert and see. Okay, you have to evert the eyelid and see. Next, we will move on to blepharitis, which is subacute or chronic inflammation of eyelid. It may be anterior blepharitis or posterior blepharitis. Anterior blepharitis may be squamous or ulcerative type. Posterior blepharitis is also called meibomitis or meibomian gland dysfunction. So this is a condition where there are presence of crust and dandruff-like materials at the base of the eyelashes, and patient usually present with itching, irritation, foreign body sensation, or heaviness of eyes like that. This is a squamous blepharitis, and the signs we can see are white dandruff-like scales at the base of the lashes or in between the lashes. These are called, if it is in between the lashes, they are called collarettes, and if it has the base of the lashes, they are called crust. So associated with seborrhea of scalp, if the patient is also having problem of dandruff in hair, it is squamous blepharitis may also occur. Other associated features like thickening of lid margin and loss of eyelashes may be present. So this is another condition where there is lid margin hyperemia and some visible yellow material. These are the crust. Okay, these are the yellow visible crust are present in the eyelid margin. this is ulcerative blepharitis, where crusts are deposited at the eye root, at the root of eyelashes, and these crusts are removed with difficulty. And while removing these crusts, sometimes the whole lashes may be pulled out, or small bleeding points or small ulcerations are visible. So other features associated may be loss of eyelashes, thickened lid margin, and misdirected eyelashes. Sometimes this small ulceration may heal to form a scar, and the eyelashes may be misdirected, that is formation of trichiasis. Okay, this is another condition where we can see there is white secretions in the both upper lid as well as lower lid. This is white paste like secretions that are coming from the meibomian gland. Also, these may be associated with frody or foamy discharge, usually at the lateral angle of the eye or at the base of the eyelid. These are white foamy discharge. So these are the common signs that we seen in, that is seen in posterior blepharitis, which is also known as meibomitis or meibomian gland dysfunction. Okay, the other signs associated in this condition are meibomian. What is this? Can you see the condition here? Is it normal? Can you see the lid condition here? Is this normal?
No, sir.
No, this is not normal. We can see there is a okay, this is one different thing. This is one different thing. Okay, this, in this condition, you can see that there is a dome sepid elevated lesion. Dome sepid elevated, maybe secretion is present, which is obstructing the opening of the meibomian gland. This is called capping. Okay, this is called capping. And another one is the pouting. Pouting is the once, okay, this is capping, like putting a cap over the head. Okay, cap is there at the opening of the meibomian gland. And sometimes these secretions are just coming out of this meibomian gland opening. These are called poutings. And when you press the eyelid, you can see the cheesy materials are coming out through the meibomian gland openings. This is called toothpaste sign. So these are the features of meibomitis. So how do we treat the blepharitis? Okay, in anterior blepharitis, lid hygiene and scrubbing with bamboo shampoo is needed in anterior blepharitis. While in posterior blepharitis or meibomitis, warm compression and vertical lid massage should be done. So antibiotic ointment should be given twice daily. Tetracycline should be initially started for mild cases, and if it is not getting okay with tetracycline, then you can go for Acopol D for severe cases. But always remember to warn patient about this steroid, because if the patient is misusing it for a long time, it may cause raised IOP leading to glaucoma, and cataract may be present. Oral antibiotics may be needed in a severe cases and recurrent cases. Capsule doxycycline, this is a very simple dose which I usually prefer to give, like this 100 milligram twice daily for 2 weeks, followed by once daily for 1 month. There are actually, it's some may give it like 10 mg for 10 days, then 50 mg twice daily for 2 weeks, followed by once daily for 1 month, like that. So that is very confusing for patient as well. So very easy dose to remember is 100 milligram twice daily for 2 weeks and once daily for 1 month. Okay. Artificial tear for tear film instability and dry eye should be given. So why there is tear film instability and dry eye in case of meibomian gland dysfunction? As we know, meibomian gland, they secrete a secretions that is called sebum, and which are which come outside to the ocular surface when during the blinking of eye, and this secretion forms the outermost part of the tear film. This is a lipid layer. Okay, tear film consists of 3 layers: outermost lipid layer, middle one is aqueous layer, and inner one is mucin layer. So this lipid layer, it comes from meibomian gland. Aqueous layer comes from lacrimal gland and accessory lacrimal gland of Crouse and Wolfring. Mucin is secreted from goblet cells of conjunctiva. Okay, and once this lipid layer is deficient in condition of meibomian gland dysfunction, so what will happen if this layer is not there? This aqueous layer will be directly in contact with the outer atmosphere. So there will be increased evaporation of aqueous layer, leading to dry eye and tear film instability. So this meibomian gland dysfunction is very common cause of evaporative type of dry eye. Okay, now next, moving to a parasitic blepharitis. This is a Thyreasis palpebrum, which is caused by crab louse Thyrus pubis. It is associated with poor hygiene and overcrowding. Genital area examination should also be done, because if it is genital area is infested, they may scrub or itching, do the itching with the hand, and once they put the hand into the eyes, this infection is transferred. Okay, so what features we can see here? These at the base of the eyelashes, there are multiple brown looking translucent structures. These are called nits, and if we look closely with torchlight, or it can be done in slit lamp examination, we can see this crab louse. This is Thyrus pubis. This, if we see on this biomicroscopy, in a biomicroscope, we can see that this lice is anchoring to the eyelash with the claws. It has three pair of claws, with help of which it is anchoring to the lashes. And these are the nits, which are also attached to the base of the eyelashes. It is usually seen as translucent pore-like structures. Okay, these are usually the lices. Is similar to lice that we see in hair, okay, in a scalp head. So how do we treat this? Manual removal of visible lice and nits should be done with help of forceps under slit lamp, and pilocarpine can be used for local application. Pilocarpine has an anti-muscarinic activity. That's why it is assumed that this anti-muscarinic activity will cause the paralysis of the legs or paralysis of the muscles of this crab louse, and it will ultimately kill it. Okay, other treatment modalities are mercuric oxide, malathione, petroleum ointment or Vaseline, ivermectin oral therapy have also been tried for this treatment. It is usually bilateral, but sometimes, rarely, it can be a unilateral. This is one case report which is published by me recently in August 2020. You can check the details about this case in the website. Coming to the next condition, that is allergic dermatitis. Allergic dermatitis, if you see in this first photograph in the upper side, this man has a history of something falling into eye. He felt it was a spider. Spider fell into this eye and followed by itching, irritation and swelling of the eyelids. Okay, so it is because of that insect. Okay, insect bite, or sometimes it can be due to that also. And this is another lady with a history of having some redness of the eyes, and he went to local shop and asked for one drop, and he was given some drop. And after putting this drop, she had these kind of symptoms. Okay, so this is allergic dermatitis because of some medicines. Okay, we don't know what medicine was given. So usual features are severe itching and swelling of the lids, and weeping eczematous lesion of the skin. That means some kind of serous discharge may also be present through the skin, and associated features like chemosis, congestion, punctate epithelial erosions may also be present. So you have to look carefully in the cornea as well. So treatment, avoid the offending agent or external irritant. If you know what is the cause, you have to avoid that. In ladies, cosmetics are the most important causes, and hair dye. Similarly, topical drugs like neomycin, penicillin, atropine, even brimonidine, they may also cause these kind of contact dermatitis. Treatment is by cold compress and low potency steroid fluoromethylone 4 times a day can be given for a short time. It should not be used for long time. Any steroid, you should never use it for long time. Antibiotic plus steroid cream over skin 2 to 3 times a day, and tablet cetirizine or tablet levocetirizine can be given once at a bedtime for a few days. If severe eyelid reaction are present, we should take dermatology consultation as well. So coming to the abnormalities of eyelashes, these are the condition: entropion, which is a inward turning or inversion of lid; outward turning or eversion is called ectropion. If there is a semicircular fold of skin covering the medial canthus, it is called epicanthus, and increased distance between canthus. Adhesion between upper and lower eyelid margin with wave of skin, it is called ankyloblepharon afferent. Adhesion between palpebral and bulbar conjunctiva is called symblepharon. Extra fold of skin in the lower lid, usually leading to entropion like features, are called epiblepharon. And enlarged palpebral aperture, enlarged horizontal palpebral aperture leading to lateral ectropion is called euryblepharon. Okay, so what could be the condition? What is this condition? This man comes with the complaint of irritation in the eyes and discharge in the eyes, and sometimes redness of eyes is present for few weeks. So what is this? What abnormality can you see? Can you see the lid margin? This lid margin, where is the eyelashes?
Yes,
inward.
Eyelashes are inward. Okay, so this is a entropion. This is entropion. Eyelashes directed inward. So this eyelashes, once it is gone inward, it will rub and cause irritation, foreign body sensation, congestion, discharge, and corneal abrasion. So you should always strain the cornea and strain the cornea and look for corneal abrasion. Common causes are involutional or age-related senile entropion. Other congenital entropion is very rare. Cicatricial entropion and acute spastic entropion are the other causes. Entropion can be graded into grade 1, 2, or 3, as I have mentioned earlier, in the margin of the eyelid. Suppose this is the posterior margin. Here are the eyelashes. This is anterior border. This is posterior border. And in between this anterior and posterior border is intermarginal stripe. Okay. So depending upon how much of the lid is inverted, we can grade this easily into grade 1 only if posterior border is enrolled, grade 2 if intermarginal stripe is interned, and if the whole of the lid or anterior margin or anterior border is also interned, it is grade 3. So it's a very simple classification. It can be also called mild, moderate, and severe, grade 1, 2, 3. So coming to management, temporary measures like lid everting suture is the commonly done procedure for temporary measures, but the recurrence is common. It works for around 6 months to 1 year. After that, recurrence will occur. And long-term measures are Weiss procedure, Jones procedure, or lower eyelid retractor advancement. These are different kind of entropion surgery. So in this old man, if you look at the lid margin, how is it? Lead margin is outward. Okay.
Outward.
Always look for the eyelashes, and it is inverted outward, and this fornix is also visible. Okay, so this is ectropion. Usual cause are involutional or senile ectropion, which is the most common cause. Other causes are cicatricial, caused by scar, paralytic, caused by seventh nerve or facial nerve palsy, and mechanical, when there is a lower eyelid tumor, it will drag the lower lid and cause ectropion. So ectropion can also be graded into 1, 2, 3, or mild, moderate, severe. It is also easy to remember. How do you remember? When only punctum is inverted or medial side is inverted, only the medial side of the lid is inverted, it is called grade 1 or mild. Once the palpebral conjunctiva is visible, then it is grade 2. And if the fornix is also visible, it is grade 3. Okay, so if this is the eyeball, suppose this is the eye and this is the eyelid. Okay, if only punctum is inverted, is medial. If palpebral conjunctiva is visible, that means the lid has turned outward and this palpebral conjunctiva is visible, then it is grade 2. And if this fornix is also visible, then it is grade 3. Okay. Okay, next we move on to the management of ectropion. In the mild cases, a grade 1 medial conjunctivoplasty or lazy T procedure is done. In moderate, ectropion correction with wedge excision is done. And in severe cases where there is lateral laxity as well or horizontal laxity is there, the lateral tarsal strip procedure is done. And for cicatricial ectropion, retroauricular skin graft for cicatricial ectropion is done. So this is a condition where this young man presented to me with the complaint of outward turning of the right lower lid. Okay, so this is the, and some scar is visible. So this is cicatricial ectropion. So for the correction of this, the scar tissue has to be released, and the gap or the after release of the scar, there is some tissue gapping, which is covered with the skin graft taken from the retroauricular area. So along with that, horizontal lid shortening procedure, lateral tarsal strip is also done. So this is the postoperative day one condition. This is another condition where there is a ectropion. This lady had this scar since the childhood because of some wound, and this scar is causing very unsightly cosmesis as well. So this is fornix is visual. This is grade 3. Okay. So here the horizontal lid shortening and the scar tissue release was done. And this was a photograph after day 7. And after 2 weeks, she had a very normal looking eyelid margin. So simuliferan is the adhesion between palpebral conjunctiva and bulbar conjunctiva. Common causes are chemical injury, thermal burn, postoperative or Stevens-Johnson syndrome. Treatment, simuliferan release is done with amniotic membrane graft to cover the raw area. This is a 50-year-old man who had the history of injury with iron nail around 20 years back, and there was a formation of simuliferan. If you can see carefully, this lower lid palpebral conjunctiva is attached to bulbar conjunctiva as well as to the cornea. Okay, this is a very severe grade of simuliferan, and surgery was done, simuliferan release and amniotic membrane transplantation was done, and on postoperative day 1, the visual axis became clear. Okay, this because of the simuliferan, it was obscuring the visual axis as well. Once the visual axis become clear, the vision also improved to 636 in day 1 and 624 to at the 1 month follow-up. Okay. Ankyloblepharon is another condition where there is a partial or complete adhesion of upper and lower eyelid. If you see in this area and in this area, the lid margins are attached. Okay. So usually it may be congenital or acquired in some viral infections or Stevens-Johnson syndrome, etc. Okay. Treatment, surgical release would be done. If you want to check details about this ankyloblepharon, I have written a page in the iWiki. You can check this ankyloblepharon and know more about it. So let's move on to abnormalities of eyelashes. Misdirection of eyelashes is called trichiasis. The direction, as I have mentioned earlier, in the upper eyelid, it is forward, upward and backward. Lower eyelid, it is forward, downward and backward. But if there is misdirection, then it is trichiasis. If there is extra row of eyelashes, it is dystichiasis. Absence of eyelashes is called madarosis, and graying of eyelashes or whitening of eyelashes is called foliosis. Okay. So what is this condition? So these are the normal lashes. Some few of the lashes are gone inward, rubbing the cornea. Okay, this is misdirection of eyelashes. It is called trichiasis. Okay. Trichiasis. Common causes are trachoma, or even in ulcerative blepharitis or chemical or thermal burn also, trichiasis may be present. So you should always look for corneal abrasion by staining the cornea, because these lashes may rough and cause superficial punctate erosions, corneal abrasion, or even frank corneal ulcer may be present. Treatment is done by epilation, which is a temporary measure, that is removal of eyelashes with help of forceps in slit lamp. You can see and remove the forceps, removed with help of forceps, but it is temporary because these eyelashes will grow in about 3 to 4 weeks it will grow. So electrolysis is the permanent treatment where electric current is used to destroy the eyelash follicles and roots. Total complete removal of the eyelashes are done. So this is a condition where beside the normal eyelashes, some extra row of eyelashes are present and it is touching the globe. Okay, this is called dystichiasis. Okay, so this is another condition. If we enlarge it and see carefully, you can see these are the normal eyelashes, but some extra row of lashes are present, and it is usually they come from the meibomian gland openings. These hair follicles, they come outside. This is called dystichiasis. So coming to ptosis, also known as blepharoptosis, is a drooping or inferior placement of eye, which can be congenital or acquired. Congenital may be simple congenital ptosis or blepharitis phimosis syndrome. It may be associated with superior rectus muscle weakness in around 10% of cases, and Marcus Gunn jaw winking syndrome if there is variation of ptosis while moving jaw or while eating. It is called Marcus Gunn jaw winking syndrome. Acquired ptosis are most commonly caused by aponeurotic or senile ptosis. Other causes are myogenic ptosis like in ocular myasthenia, neurogenic ptosis like in Thordner palsy, and mechanical ptosis like in upper eyelid tumor, which will, with gravity, it will pull the upper lid and doesn't let it lift up. So ptosis evaluation, what are the things you need to evaluate? You should look, ask for history, inspection, ocular examination, ptosis measurement, and other examination. History, you should ask for the age of onset. It is congenital or acquired. Any variation, any diurnal variation, like the ptosis were not present in the morning, but as the day ends, in the evening time, there will be increased amount of ptosis. This is the typical feature of ocular myasthenia or myasthenic ptosis. Jaw winking, while moving the jaw, if there is variability of amount of ptosis. Any predisposing factors like past history of trauma, eye surgery, because they may also induce aponeurotic ptosis. And contact lens use, especially hard contact lens users, they may have this aponeurotic ptosis because of disinsertion of levator muscle from the tarsal plate. Family history should be asked. Similarly, relevant past history and old photographs should be checked if there is any confusion. Okay, inspection, you have to check whether it is unilateral or bilateral, compare the facial symmetry or palsy, abnormal head posture like head tilt, face turn, or chin lift, or chin up and down, this should be noted. And overaction of frontalis should be noted. Forehead crease, you can look for the forehead crease, like because of inability to lift the lid with the levator muscle, they will tend to lift the eyelid with help of forehead muscle, frontalis muscle. So forehead crease like this will be visible if they try to forcefully open the lid. And eyebrow positions will be higher. Ocular examination, best corrected visual acuity and cycloplegic refraction should be done in congenital ptosis in children, because refractive error are very commonly associated, and this may lead to anisometropic amblyopia in children. And if the ptosis is very severe, it may cause stimulus deprivation amblyopia. So vision is very important. Cornea exposure keratitis, corneal sensitivity should be noted. Pupil size and reaction should be noted, because it will be dilated in case of Thordner palsy or congenital Horner syndrome. Iris heterochromia is present in Horner syndrome. Ocular motility should be checked, and abnormal pigmentation in fundus is visible in chronic progressive external ophthalmoplasia. Ptosis measurement. There are major 5 clinical measurements: vertical fissure height, margin reflex distance, levator function, margin crease distance, and presence of lagophthalmos should be checked and noted if it is present. Other examination include lead lag, Bell's phenomena, jaw winking phenomena, Surmer test, and tear breakup time for dry eyes. So this is a very important measurement, marginal reflex distance 1 and margin reflex distance 2. So what is this? When you throw a light with the help of a torch light, you can see the corneal reflex, light reflex in the pupillary area. The distance of upper eyelid from this pupillary area is called MRD1, and distance of lower eyelid from the pupillary light reflex, it is called MRD2. Okay, so normal MRD1 is 4 to 5 millimeter, MRD2 is 5 to 6 millimeter. So MRD1 plus MRD2 is equal to vertical fissure height. It is around 7 to 10 millimeter in male and slightly more, 8 to 12 millimeter in female. So this is the main important measurement is MRD1. So grading of severity of ptosis can be done. Like in, if it is a unilateral case, then difference between the two, okay, difference of vertical fissure height between the two can be measured and can be classified into mild, moderate, severe. But if it is a bilateral case, then the amount of cornea covered by the upper eyelid should be measured, and then subtracting 2 millimeter from it, it will give the amount of ptosis. Okay, so normally this upper eyelid is covering 2 millimeter of ptosis. If 2 millimeter is more is covered, then it is mild ptosis. 3 millimeter more is moderate ptosis, and 4 millimeter or more is severe ptosis. Another important measurement is the LPS axon, which is measured by using Burkitt's method, where we ask the patient to look downward first, and from the extreme down gaze to extreme up gaze, what is the movement of the eyelid? So that is the amount of levator axon. But you have to negate the action of frontalis by pressing the forehead, just above the brow, pressing the forehead, so that the frontalis will not come into play in uplifting the eyelid. So it can be graded as poor if it is less than 4 millimeter, fair if it is 5 to 7, good 8 to 12, and excellent if it is 13 to 15. So why do we need to measure this levator function? Because it will help to determine the type of surgery or course of a treatment. Okay, so the choice of surgery will depend upon the severity of ptosis and amount of levator action. Okay, if it is mild ptosis with good LPS action, Fasanella Servet surgery is done. If it is severe or moderate ptosis with poor LPS action, then frontalis surgery is done. And for fair LPS action, LPS resection surgery can be done. So it is very important to measure these measurements correctly. So what are the difference between congenital and senile ptosis? Congenital ptosis, they appear at birth or immediately after birth, and 75% of cases they are unilateral, while in senile ptosis they appear in old age and usually bilateral. Upper lid crease is absent in congenital ptosis and present in senile ptosis. Down gaze lid lag is present in congenital ptosis, and ptosis is worse in down gaze in senile ptosis. Levator function is usually poor in congenital ptosis and good in senile ptosis. Other sign like superior rectus weakness may be associated with congenital ptosis, but in senile ptosis, thin eyelid and deep upper eyelid sulcus are present. Brow suspension is a treatment of choice in congenital ptosis. Aponeurosis repair is done in senile ptosis. So in case of congenital ptosis, when do we do surgery? Since it is appearing after birth, do we need to do the surgery immediately or not? This is a very important question. Treatment depends on severity of ptosis and presence of amblyopia. So if the visual axis is clear and there is no amblyopia, then the surgery can be deferred till the age of 3 to 4 years of age. And usually at the school going age, surgery is performed, but early surgery may be needed if visual axis is obscured. That may lead to stimulus deprivation amblyopia, or if there is high anisometropic amblyopia, then this surgery should be done. Or if the patient are very concerned or parents are very concerned about the cosmesis, then also surgery can be done. Okay, so this is a photograph of bilateral severe congenital ptosis, where bilateral congenital ptosis is there. You can note the frontalis overaction leading to high contour of the eyebrow. Okay. And after the surgery, you can note the eyebrow. They are very relaxed and are in normal position. And also the vertical fissure height has increased, clearing the visual axis. So this is another congenital ptosis with the right eye mild congenital ptosis, in which frontal is. I'm getting very disturbing sound. Can who is this? Can you mute yourself? Okay, this is a mild ptosis where the frontalis sling surgery was done. It's a bilateral senile aponeurotic ptosis where you can note there is a presence of high sulcus. Okay, this is a superior sulcus as I was mentioning. This is a superior sulcus which is very high, and if you palpate it, it is very thin eyelid and atrophic tarsus may be felt. Okay, and in this bilateral levator advancement surgery was done. This is a after surgery. Sometime in because of old age, there may be presence of loose and redundant eyelid skin, and they may be sagging downward. Okay, like with gravity, they may tend to come downward and cover the eyes like this. Okay, this is called lateral hooding. This is sagging. Okay, this is age related changes. This is known as dermatocalysis. Treatment is blepharoplasty, cosmetic for cosmetic and functional purpose. Coming to some congenital lip abnormalities, these are the lip abnormalities which we will be briefly talking. Congenital ptosis, we have already discussed. This is a lid coloboma where there is a absence of upper eyelid, absence of some part of upper eyelid. Usually upper eyelid is involved and central part of the upper eyelid is involved. There's a notch at the edge of the lid. So how do we treat? It is treated with lid reconstruction, and it should be done at the very early age, because if the eye remain exposed, there may be exposure keratitis leading to corneal ulceration, and the eye may be damaged for ever. Okay. So in this case, surgery was done, upper eyelid reconstruction was done, and this is a postoperative day one condition where this two are suture, and after making a lateral keratotomy and semicircular flap is created so as to increase the mobility of lid. So this is another condition where there is extra fold of skin in the lower lid and inward turning of lid margin occurs, leading to entropion like features, that is foreign body sensation, rubbing of because of rubbing, and sometimes discharge and corneal erosions may be present. Treated with modified Hodge procedure or lower eyelid retractor advancement. So this was, he was operated, and this is the post of day one. This is after 2 weeks. The eyelashes are now turned outward and it is not rubbing cornea. You see this photograph here, you can see the clearly the eyelashes are turned inward and rubbing the cornea. This is an extra fold of skin. Okay, this fold of skin is causing this trouble. So in modified Hodge procedure, what we do is usually we give an incision and remove this some part of skin, and lower eyelid retractors are attached to the lower eyelid tarsus plate so that it can turn outward. Okay, next is the eyelid tumors. Eyelid tumor may be divided into benign and malignant tumor. Benign tumors, papilloma, hemangioma, neurofibroma, and nevus are the common ones. Malignant tumors, basal cell carcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, meibomian gland carcinoma, and malignant melanoma. So this is the papilloma where it can present as a pedunculated skin tag. Pedunculated means some peduncle is there, some attachment site is there. This is pedunculated. And if it is not so, then it is called sessile. Okay, this is a papilloma. It is treated with a simple excision of the lesion. This is the capillary hemangioma, where there is a presence of superficial bright or red condition, bright red lesion in the usually in the upper lid or lower lid. This condition may be present. If it is deep, if it is deep variety or deep hemangioma, it is bluish or purple in color and usually they present very late. 40% of lesions completely involved by age 4 and 80% involved by age 8. So immediate surgery are not required, but serial observation should be done when if the visual axis is clear. Always check for the visual axis. If visual axis is clear, there is no risk of amblyopia, then the patient, a child, can be kept under observation. But if there is a chance of amblyopia, visual axis is covered, and severe cosmetic defect is present, then early treatment is indicated. Okay, so what are the treatment options? Is a beta blocker, oral propranolol after pediatric consultation, topical timolol for local application, intralesional steroid injection, triamcinolone can be tried, systemic steroid if large orbital component is present, and surgical excision is usually reserved for the cases where conservative therapy has failed or tumor removal is necessary, then surgical excision is done. Okay, this is a child who presented with the upper eyelid superficial hemangioma at the age of 4 months, and for him I gave a topical timolol application and was kept under observation because the visual axis was almost clear. And after 2 months, the lesion subsided, and after next 9 months, the lesion has almost completely disappeared. Okay, so this was that child which I showed earlier. She was presented to me at the age of 3 months. She had the left upper lid hemangioma since it was not covering the visual axis, and I kept her on the topical timolol therapy. And after 3 months, you can see that there is decrease in the size of the hemangioma, and after 6 months the lesion was almost completely cleared. Okay, so topical timolol therapy is very safe and not used much by practitioner, but I have found a very good result of this therapy, and I have presented a poster in Eastern Regional Ophthalmic Conference in 2020. It's a resolution of capillary hemangioma in eyelid with topical application of topical timolol. A case series was presented, and soon I will be publishing a paper in this. Neurofibroma are a characteristic S-shaped deformity of upper lid. It causes mechanical ptosis. Plexiform neurofibroma is the most common type, and we should always look for systemic neurofibromatosis, where multiple neurofibroma lesions may be present in various parts of the body like hand, legs, chest, back. These are the features. Treatment with simple excision for a small solitary lesion and removal of diffuse plexiform lesion are difficult, and incomplete removal may occur, and along with that, ptosis correction may be needed. Very common, and they present with the these two variety of nevus. One is junctional nevus, one is compound nevus. These are the blackish or brownish mass present at the lid. They usually tend to grow very slowly, and there is very small risk of transforming into a malignant lesion as well. So if it is causing cosmetic problem, or if there are some malignant changes, then you can go for complete excision of mass. Man present with this lesion for last 6 months. So what could be the diagnosis of this lesion? So this is a raised elevated ulcer. Ulceration, deep ulceration is there. Margin is rolled margin. So what could be the diagnosis?
Basal cell carcinoma.
Basal cell carcinoma is the diagnosis. Okay. This is the most common malignant tumor. It's usually present in the sun exposed part, and lower eyelid is the most common, followed by medial canthus, followed by medial upper lid and lateral canthus. This is the sequence of, this is the sequence where they usually present. So raised is central ulceration, and they pain to penetrate deeply. That's why it is also known as rodent ulcer. Okay. Squamous cell carcinoma. This is the second most common malignancy of the eyelid. Nodular ulcerated lesion are seen, and growth rate is faster than basal cell carcinoma, and they tend to spread to lymph node. So that's why it is more dangerous than the basal cell carcinoma. Meibomian gland carcinoma, as I have already shared this picture before, this can mimic as a recurrent calagen. They arise from meibomian gland. They're also known as sebaceous gland carcinoma because meibomian gland is a modified sebaceous gland. Treatment of the eyelid lesion, in general, small lesions are treated with simple mass excision. Large lesions are treated with mass excision and lead reconstruction. Sometimes post-operative radiotherapy may be needed. Exenteration is indicated if tumor is invading globe or orbit in neglected cases. Okay, this patient presented to me with the left upper eyelid sebaceous gland carcinoma, and the excision of upper eyelid mask was done followed by reconstruction, and this is a post-operative photograph. This patient presented to me with upper eyelid meibomian gland carcinoma. He had a history of mass excision at the same site around 3 years back, and there was a recurrence of this mass, and I did the lead mass excision and lead reconstruction, and he is doing well for last 2-3 years. There is no history of any recurrence, and I hope there won't be any. This is the left upper lid squamous cell carcinoma. This is the mass present in the upper lid, lateral part of the upper lid. This is a intraop photograph at the end of the surgery. Mass excision with the lead reconstruction surgery was done with lateral semicircular tangential flap, and this is a follow-up after 1 month where the healing has occurred and some scar is there, but it is cosmetically acceptable as compared to this photograph. Okay, so this concludes our lecture, and if you have any question, we can go to the questions.
All right, Dr. Sabine, thank you so much for such a wonderful session. So practically lots of things going on my mind, and I think similarly lots of queries we can get from the audience. Yeah. So I'm going to share the screen. So one by one. So let me share my screen.
Okay. Yeah, I can see.
Yes. So let me Deepak. The slide. Yes. So this is the question from the Noor Muhammad. Can you
see it? These are from YouTube, right?
Yes. These are the YouTube. Yeah.
Okay. Noor Muhammad. Okay. Why antacid given? Antacidic given in internal radiology. I cannot see this question. Why antacid given in internal radiolum? What is the difference in external and internal radiolum with clinical photograph? I think I have already shown the clinical photograph. STI is called external radiolum, and internal radiolum is infected calagen. Okay, so that's the simple thing. And internal radiolum is a painful condition where analgesic should be given, and any analgesic has as a side effect, they cause gastric erosion and peptic ulcer disease may be present. That's why antacid are given. Okay. Can we move on to next question, please?
Hello. So can you see it, sir?
Yeah. Miss Asmita Madan. I cannot see the question in YouTube. Okay. Hi, Dr. Sabin. After surgery of calagen, we found a recurrence in many cases. What is the reason behind it? How can we help them as surgery does not heal permanently? Okay, obviously surgery heal permanently, but as I have mentioned, sometimes this collagen may have malignant transformation and there may be meibomian gland carcinoma. Okay, so one of the most common cause of recurrence, especially if it is old age, then meibomian gland carcinoma should be suspected. And other causes of recurrence are during the removal of collagen. If only the content are removed, but the fibrous capsule is not completely removed, then there may be recurrence of the collagen. Okay. So, and this is a wrong concept. Right? Surgery does not heal permanently. This is very wrong concept. Obviously, surgery will heal, but depending on who the surgeon is and how his technique is. Okay. you can refer the patient to me. I will heal them completely. Okay.
All right. So
next question, please.
Another question, yeah.
Hi, Dr. Sabin. Why only baby shampoo is used and what can be alternative? You can try with the detergent powder and see how irritant it is to the eye. Okay. But baby shampoos, they are very soft to the eye and they do not have any irritation to the eye and they don't have this burning sensation. Because of that, baby shampoo are indicated. Otherwise, if you are comfortable with the irritation, you can use detergent, any detergent also.
Okay, let's move to the another question.
Okay.
All right, here is another question.
What is the mechanism of timolol therapy for hemangioma, Deepshika Bhusal? She has asked a very high intellectual question. Basically, timolol is a beta blocker. And beta blockers, if you see the histology of capillary blood vessels, this capillary endothelium, they consist of alpha receptors and beta receptors, and these are the receptors where the vascular endothelial growth factors act and the proliferation of these capillaries occur, leading to the capillary hemangioma. So the mechanism of this timolol is blocking those beta receptors so that the vascular endothelial growth factors, they may not get the access to those receptors, leading to further chain of the proliferation. So that is the basic mechanism how it works.
This is a very clinically sound question, right?
Yeah. I hope I answered it in a very simple way.
All right. So let's move to the another question. Yeah. All right. So
what is tensilin test in ptosis? Deepak Kuswa, I am glad he is attending this class again today because he has already attended before also. Okay, tensilin test is also known as hydroponium test, which is done for the, it is a diagnostic test for the myasthenic ptosis. Okay, myasthenia is I got one question previously, which I could not answer. Okay, myasthenia is a systemic disease in where there is a problem with neuromuscular junction. Okay, some of the acetylcholine receptors are damaged because of the autoantibodies that are developed in the body. Okay, and tensilin test, what it does is we inject some amount of hydroponium. Okay, hydroponium is a compound, and it will temporarily block those antibodies, and somehow they will not let them damage those acetylcholine receptors. And because of that, there will be relief of the ptosis and there will be improvement of ptosis will be seen because of that. So that is one of a diagnostic test of myasthenic ptosis. And the other, but it is a little dangerous in sense, risky in sense, because of some acute anaphylactic shock and even hypersensitivity reaction may occur because due to hydroponium. And so it is not usually performed by common practitioner, or it should be performed under supervision. But the simple and easy test you can do for myasthenic ptosis is ice pack test. Okay, ice pack test, what we do is put the ice pack over the eyelid for around 2 to 5 minutes. And after that, if you note any difference of the MRD1, as I have mentioned, if you see the some improvement of ptosis is seen, if minimum 2 millimeter or more than 2 millimeter increase of MRD1 is seen, then the test is called positive. So that is a good screening, simple and easy screening test for myasthenic ptosis.
All right.
Thank you. Next question.
All right, let's move to another question. Yes. Maybe these were the only questions that I picked from YouTube. So, I can see a few more questions on the Zoom chat. So should I read for you or you can see it?
Yeah, I think from chat I can read it directly. You know? That will save our time. Okay, if you have any more questions, we can quickly go through within 5 minutes. I can get some questions. Okay, differential diagnosis between ptosis and myasthenia gravis. Differential diagnosis between ptosis and myasthenia gravis. What do you mean to say? I have already mentioned all the causes of ptosis and myasthenia gravis. I think I have briefly touched about that. If ocular feature is very common in systemic myasthenia gravis as well. If only ocular feature is called, it is also called ocular myasthenia. And how do we diagnose? Because the diurnal variability and the test I have mentioned, ice pack test, hypophoneme test, that you can do. Okay. Deepshikha has asked another question. If the child have severe congenital ptosis with squint, which surgery is mandated first and why? This is a very good question. Ms. Deepshikha, she works in a pediatric department and I was in arthroplasty department, and they used to refer to me lots of patients with squint, and I always refer back to them. Do some squint surgery first and then listen to me. Okay. So always remember, squint has to be corrected first before you even attempt to do ptosis surgery. Even ptosis evaluation should be properly done only after the squint surgery, because after, once you correct the eyelid, your correction of eyelid is always relative. Okay. Relative to your eye position of the eyeball and relative to the other eye as well. Okay. Once you correct the eyelid, that lead is fixed. Okay. You cannot change that. Okay. After that, if you do the squint surgery and there is change of the position of the eyeball, then that ptosis surgery will not be perfect. Okay. So always you should correct the squint first and then correct congenital ptosis. Ms. Jyoti Gupta has asked, sir, how to differentiate external and internal hernium? As I have mentioned, external hernium is simply sty. Remember the features of it. Sty. Internal hernium is a infected collagen. Okay. So how do we differentiate? Both are painful condition, but the differentiating condition is nodular swellings. They will be slightly away from lead margin in the internal hernium, while it will be at the lead margin in the external hernium. Some pus point with at the base of the last follicle may be present in the external hernium, and those kind of pus point at the base of the lasses will not be visible in the internal hernium. So these are the, you just remember the basic pathology, external hernium that occurs in the gland of Zeiss and Moll, which is at the base of the eyelash, and internal hernium is in the meibomian gland, which is in the tarsal plate. Vikas Kumar has asked, sir, can you elaborate the role of pilocarpate in the treatment of thyriasis palpebrarum? Okay. See, as I have mentioned, I think more than the pilocarpine, the mechanical removal of those lice and nits is the main thing. And pilocarpine, it is said that it has anti-muscarinic activity. So that is the only action. But if you can remove the lice and nits directly with the forceps, then there is no need to paralyze that lice and then let that drug act to kill that lice. Okay, if you can just see the lice, just remove it. That's all. So this is not so definite or hard and fast treatment that you have to give pilocarpine to kill that lice and nits. But it has been said, because of those actions, anti-muscarinic actions, it will paralyze the muscles of the lice. That is, muscles means in the limbs and even in the body. If all the muscles are paralyzed, it is not able to move, and then it will die. That's the simple concept. Okay. Can we take more questions? I think we have two more questions.
Okay, so one more from Mahato. So if you have time and we can take, otherwise you have already answered lots of questions.
Okay. Gyan Mahato, Marcus Gunn jaw winking phenomena present only in congenital ptosis or in also in acquired ptosis? Okay, it is present only in congenital ptosis, and acquired ptosis, they won't develop synkinetic condition like that, because what it is called is a, there is a synkinetic connection between the trigeminal nerve, which are supplying the mandible. Okay, the jaws are moved with help of the mandibular nerve, which is a branch of trigeminal nerve, and eyelid is lifted up by the levator palpebrae superior muscle, which is supplied by oculomotor nerve. So it is sometimes also called trigemino-ocular synkinetic condition. Okay, this condition is usually present since birth or congenital in nature.
All right. So these were the only questions we are taking so far, right, doctor?
Yeah. So, all right. So I can see one question difference right. between basal cell carcinoma and squamous cell carcinoma, I think I have mentioned clearly in the slides. You can go through that. Once again, one last question is, sir, can you please explain a bit about LPS axon? Okay, LPS axon, levator palpebral superioris, is the main muscle which lifts the upper eyelid. Okay, explain a bit about LPS axon. This question is not so clear. I think he wants to ask about the
actually about the frontalis.
Yeah. Uh-huh. What do you want to ask, Amit?
About frontalis measuring.
Okay, okay. Okay, yeah. You want to know about the measurement. Okay. Yeah. See, if you try to lift the eyelid like this, you can see yeah. that this eyebrow is also being lifted because of frontalis action, and yes. eyelid is lifted up with the LPS action. Okay. Mm-hmm. So there are basically two muscles that are acting to lift our eyelid. One is frontalis muscle and one is levator muscle. So somehow mm-hmm. if we can negate the action of this frontalis muscle, so which muscle is yes. remaining? Only LPS muscle is remaining. That's how we can measure the function of or amount of the activity that is being done by LPS. So if you look at the down gaze, okay, yes. and quickly move at the up gaze, then frontalis and LPS is acting to lift the eye. But if you press the eyebrow, you can check it yourself. If you press the just above the brow, if you press it like this and do the same, look downward and then look upward, then the lifting of the eyelid is slightly diminished. Yes. Can you notice? Okay.
Yeah,
if
yeah.
you press it, lifting of the eyelid is slightly diminished. Only that part is because of LPS action. And we have to measure that amount only. Okay. Because that will determine the course of the further action. Okay, further type of the surgery and the prognosis will be determined with that action.
Yes, sir. Okay, thank you, sir.
I think that is clear. Yeah. I think I have answered almost all questions.
Okay, so thank you so much, Dr. Sabin. This is an extremely useful session for me and the clinical moving inside me. I mean, these are the clinical, you know, clinical photographs that you have take from mm-hmm. your all heart sieve. I know it's mm-hmm. how much it's take a time to, you know, collect mm-hmm. all these pictures and presenting in the one slide. Mm-hmm. It's really overwhelming for all of us. Once again, thank you so much for such a wonderful session. And I'd like to announce you all that I have just dropped the review and feedback file. And I'd like to share you that Dr. Sabin is waiting for your valuable insight. I mean, well, feedback from you. So I request you, all of you, kindly through the feedback file and give your genuine suggestion, feedback and review from your side. Dr. Sabin will be happy to improve the session.
Yes, yes, yes. Thank you. Thank you.
All right. So these were the only things. And I would like to share information regarding the, you know, these videos. Actually, these videos all stored in the website. You can visit the www.miroeye.com/academy. We have a three different website in Miroeye. The first, you know, is, first one is home, second one is the academy, and last is journal and magazine. So these all are stored in the Miroeye Academy. So you can go to the miroeye.com/academy. You can see there is 2L sub-specialty program, and you can choose US by PUS for optimist by Dr. Sabin, and you can enjoy all the, you know, PPTs, videos, and all and everything over there. And we have also request you to do the assignment, and we are looking for the volunteers to submit the, you know, all together all these slides into a note. So if you want to apply and if you want to enroll in the PUS, I request you all kindly you know, go with the fill up form, and you can submit your request, and we'll be connected with you by the mail. So once again, thank you so much, Dr. Sabin, for all this session and for POS and our this morning be valuable. And so once again, thank you so much. And before ending the session, if you have any notes, I request you to share with all of us.
Yeah, thank you every one of you who have attended this class and being very patient. And I hope if you have any feedback, you can go through the feedback form and give me the feedback regarding the quality of this course and regarding my
sir. Astika quiz kulena.
Okay, Astika quiz kulena. ओके कपिल जी अस्तिको क्विज खुलेन हेर्नुस
ओके ज्योति जी सो दिस इज द एलएमएस सिस्टम वेयर वी स्टोर ऑल दिस एमसीक्यूज फर द हु आर ओन्ली रजिस्टर्ड इन आवर वेबसाइट सो तपाईले के गर्न सक्नुहुन्छ भने एकाडेमीमा जानुहोस् तपाईँले आफूलाई पहिला रजिस्टर गर्नुपर्छ तपाईँको प्रोफाइल तपाईँले कसरी पढ्नु भएको छ के छ तपाईँको कति कोर्सहरू चाहिँ कति आवर्स स्पेन्ड गर्नु भएको छ यो सबै कुराहरू रेकर्ड हुन्छ वेबसाइटमा है सो यो कुराहरू इभ्यालुएसन गरेर तपाईँहरूलाई हामीले सर्टिफिकेट दिनु हो त्यसको हुनाले तपाईँले जबसम्म आफूलाई वेबसाइटमा रजिस्टर गर्न एकाडेमी मेरो आई छुट्टै हो एकाडेमी चाहिँ छुट्टै हो सो यु क्यान गो टु द एकाडेमी एन्ड यु क्यान रजिस्टर युर सेल्फ एन्ड आफ्टर रजिस्ट्रेसन एभ्रिथिङ इज फ्री एन्ड यु क्यान इनरोल इन टु द क्विज
जति बेसिकली मैले धेरैजनाको प्रब्लममा के भेटाएँ भने नि मोबाइलबाट जब एसेस गरिन्छ त्यति बेलामा चाहिँ त्यो लक लागेको हुँदो रहेछ कि त्यो लक खुलेको हुँदैन अरे अनि त्यसमा चाहिँ मोबाइलमा के गर्नु पर्दो रहेछ भन्दा डेस्कटप साइट भन्ने गरेर त्यसमा जुन कोर्सको मुनितिर एउटा फ्री स्टार्ट नाउ भन्ने एउटा बटन छ त्यो स्टार्ट नाउ भन्ने क्लिक गरेपछि अनि त्यो रिफ्रेस भएपछि चाहिँ त्यो लक खुल्ने गर्दछ र त्योभन्दा पहिला लगइन गर्नुपर्ने हुन्छ त्यसपछि डेस्कटप साइट गर्नुपर्ने हुन्छ र करिकुलममा कोर्सभित्र करिकुलममा त्यो क्वेसनहरू त्यहाँ एभाइलेबल हुन्छ
एक्ज्याक्टली डेस्कटप भ्यूमा जानुहोस् तपाईँसँग ल्यापटप छ भने या ल्यापटप युज गर्नुहोस् यदि तपाईँसँग ल्यापटप छैन भने मोबाइलबाट गर्न खोजिरहनु भएको छ भने डेस्कटप भ्यूमा जानुहोस् त्यहाँबाट आफूलाई पहिला रजिस्टर गर्नुहोस् टेक दिस कोर्स गर्नुहोस् कोर्समा इनरोल गर्नुहोस् अनि सबै कुराहरू चाहिँ तपाईँलाई एभाइलेबल हुन्छ ओके थ्याङ्क यू सो मच डाक्टर सबिन वन्स अगेन एन्ड आई अनाउन्स क्लोज अफ टुडे सेसन हियर विल बी मिट अन नेक्स्ट ट्युजडे अन द शार्प 7:30 AM थ्याङ्क यू सो मच all your passion thank you so much
okay thank you everyone okay stay safe have a good day